Good morning, everybody. Come on in and find a seat, and we'll get started here. Just want to remind everybody that we are in the season of Lent, and Lent is a period to kind of prepare ourselves for Easter, where Jesus died and rose again. And many traditions have a time before Lent where we think of maybe something that you would like to either give up or focus on in order to prepare yourself. And it kind of reminds us of how Jesus prepared himself to go to the cross and rise again. Fortunately, we don't have to die on the cross. Jesus already did that for us. But it's good for us to prepare. Good Friday is the 30th of March, so it's early this year. So keep that in mind, and we will be having a joint service down at First Baptist Church with a number of other churches for Good Friday. We also have a Maundy Thursday service, which is a more contemplative service. We can pray together on the Thursday. And then Palm Sunday, we will have a pancake brunch after the service. And then also there's a couple other events coming up, a little ways out yet, but we're going to have our anniversary Sunday, May 27th. And also, April 8th, we're going to have a baptismal service and a potluck afterwards. So we have lots of fun things planned coming up that you can keep an eye on. Also, there is some Bible studies that you can notice in your bulletin. So just keep some of those things in mind. I think the other announcements you can read there. Jesus said in John 15 that we didn't choose him. He chose us to go and bear fruit. And we want to talk a little bit about what God has for us today. Let's bow in prayer as we begin our service. Lord, thank you so much for this beautiful day. Thank you for beautiful people. Thank you for each person that is here today. I pray that you would encourage every heart and every person that's here. God, make us keenly aware that we are in your presence and that you have called us to this place. And I pray that as we worship you today, that you would bring joy and encouragement for those of us that are struggling. And I pray that you would just fill the loneliness with your companionship. God, I just pray that you would give us hearts of praise as we worship you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Vic's going to come and lead us.
I want to get you to stand, and we're going to sing 10,000 Reasons. All righty. It's on the screen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me sing as the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will go on singing 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless my Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. before. Hold my soul, I'll worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is falling, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praises unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, O worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Worship your holy name.
379 in your hymn books, Christ the Redeemer. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. But now a righteousness from God, apart from law, has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. The righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference, for all have sinned, fall short the glory of God, and are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. He did this to demonstrate his justice, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. For this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver and gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. My faith and hope are in God. Amen. Let's keep singing.
Turn to number 680 in your hymn book, please. 680, or watch the screen all the way my Savior leads me.
All the way my Savior leads me, what have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divine is comfort, here by faith in him to dwell. For I know upon before me, a Jesus doeth all things well. For I know whatever before, trials, feed me with the living
Turn over to number 532. 532, Only Believe. How many believe that this morning? Wonderful. Okay, do it one more time. Is that all right? Okay, thank you. The pastor's given the word. All right, one more time. All right. Only believe. Only believe. All things are possible. Only believe. Only believe. Only believe, all things are possible. Only believe. Thank you. Be seated, please.
Thanks, Vic. Thanks for good singing. Now it's time for this morning's offering. Just a reminder that we have a benevolent fund that we keep confidential, and we use the funds from that fund to help people in our congregation and people that come to us who are in real need. And so at the discernment of the elders of the church, we pass that out from time to time. And so we'd encourage you, on top of your regular giving, to think about maybe giving an extra gift towards that. And that really helps us with some of those kind of needs that come up. It's time for offering, if the ushers would like to come to the front. Let's stand together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated. There is Sunday school this morning if the kids want to go down, and nursery for those that are preschool as well. It's time for us to pray together. Aren't you glad that there's nice warm weather coming? Isn't it nice? God is faithful, and God has been good to us. Let's just bow in prayer. Lord, thank you so much for your goodness. Thank you for the warmer weather. Thank you for giving us health to be here this morning. Thank you for looking after our needs and providing for us so we can eat and be looked after. Thank you for your grace in Jesus. Thank you that you're our Father. Thank you that you want a relationship with us, and that you sent your Son Jesus to die because you love us so much, to make a way for us to enter into a relationship with you. God, we just thank you for each person here this morning. Thank you for the blessing they are to us. Lord, I thank you for the encouragement that comes from just being together, the encouragement that comes from your love and your comfort. Thank you for your Holy Spirit that comes to us and guides us and comforts us and advises us and fills us with power and directs us and speaks to us. God, we just thank you for this country that we live in, where we benefit from so many different things, from freedom to worship you, freedom in our law, the order that we have. God, I just thank you for the blessings we received here. God, just continue to watch over the leaders of this country, give them the courage to put you first in their decision making, and continue to work in the laws of this country and in this government in Alberta to promote truth and promote righteousness. And God, we just pray as you've taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Vic's going to come and lead us.
I'm going to ask you to stand one more time, please, and turn to number 690. 690, or watch the screen, please.
He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O words with heavenly comfort wrought. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still gives God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. Lord, I would clasp thy hand in mine, nor ever murmur, nor repine, content whatever lot I see, since 'tis my God that leads.
Good morning. The scripture this morning comes from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 to 8. Now I'll be reading from the Good News Bible. In the presence of God and of Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead, and because he is coming to rule as king, I solemnly urge you to preach the message, to insist upon proclaiming it, whether the time is right or not, to convince, reproach, and encourage, as you teach with all patience. The time will come when people will not listen to the sound doctrine, but will follow their own desires and will collect for themselves more and more teachers who will tell them what they are itching to hear. They will turn away from listening to the truth and give their attention to legends. But you must keep control of yourself in all circumstances. Endure suffering, do the work of a preacher of the good news, and perform your whole duty as a servant of God. As for me, the hour has come for me to be sacrificed. The time is here for me to leave this life. I have done my best in the race. I have run the full distance, and I have kept the faith. And now there is waiting for me the victory prize of being put right with God, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And not only to me, but to all those who wait with love for him to appear.
Thanks, Landon. I don't know whose kid that is. Great kid. Well, we've been looking at the series on the story and looking through the scriptures. And last week we talked about how the exiles came back from Babylon and were there to rebuild the temple. And this week, we want to talk a little bit more about Esther. And if you've read the story of Esther, you realize that there was something special about her being put in the place she was at. Have you ever been in a place where you're just at the right place at the right time to see something or do something? I remember about probably 20 years ago when we were at our first church and our kids were little, we were at some friends on their farm, and all of the adults were kind of in the house, milling around and chatting and everything, things adults do. And the kids were outside playing near the barn. And it was one of those typical old, you know, kind of red farm barns with the loft, you know, the hay loft up top. And they had a kind of a line, kind of a zip line from the barn down to near the house. And the kids would hang on to this and swing down and have great fun. Well, as we were talking, all of a sudden I hear this yell coming from the barn. And without hardly even thinking about what was going on, I just took off for the barn. And I got there just in time to watch my son fall from the loft, and I just caught him just in the nick of time. Just talk about being there just at the right time. I mean, he could have broke his leg or could have died. Who knows? But just at the right time. Now, in life, sometimes things happen like that, where we don't plan it, but it just happens that we happen to be there at the right time. Somebody famous goes by and you just happen to be there. Sometimes, though, we're in the right place at the right time because we've actually planned to be there. We've planned to do something and we're there. I remember a number of years ago, I ran for the school board and was on the school board in the Wetaskiwin area. And one of the neat things that came out of that experience was I got to chair a committee for all of Alberta looking at respect for faith and religion in public schools. And I really felt like God had placed me there for something important at that time. And it also led to other opportunities to pray in front of 500 school trustees and in front of the MLAs and so on, the premier. And I just felt very humbled to be serving God in that capacity, not because I was any better than anybody else, but God had put me in this place for a time. And so the important question that we often need to ask is, where has God placed you? And why has he put you where you are? And is there something that God has placed you to do? I want us to turn to the book of Esther in the Old Testament. And we want to look at a lady who was in the right place at the right time. Now, if you remember what I said about the exiles coming back to Israel, there was two waves that came back. The first wave came and worked on rebuilding the temple. And then a second wave came along and helped with some of the spiritual reformation with Ezra the prophet and so on. They read the scriptures, if you read the book of Ezra. And somewhere between chapter 6 and 7 of Ezra is where the book of Ezra takes place. Esther takes place historically. Now, if you start at the beginning of chapter 1, it says this. This is what happened during the time of Xerxes. Some translations use Ahasuerus. Ahasuerus and Xerxes are the same person, same name, but just in different translations, different languages, kind of like my name's Greg in English, but if you want to translate it into something else, it'll probably be different, like Gregoire or something in French, you know. But this is what happened in the time of Xerxes. The Xerxes who ruled over 127 provinces stretching from India to Kush. In other words, from all the way over from Pakistan and India, he reigned all the way over to Egypt and northern Sudan. So this is a huge empire. And at that time, King Xerxes reigned from his royal throne in the citadel of Susa. Susa was one of three main capitals in the Persian Empire, often was used as their winter palace, located in what's near what is today Baghdad. And in the third year of his reign, verse 3, he gave a banquet for all his nobles and officials. The military leaders of Persia and Media, the princes and nobles of the province, were present. Now, history tells us that Xerxes was a pretty good king. He did a lot of good things for his people. But he also, besides being generous and serving well, he was also quite diabolical on his off days. It's kind of, you know, that good cop, bad cop kind of image, you know. He was good some of the time, good king sometimes, and a terrible king at other times. And so you never know which king was going to show up. And so the people in the royal courts were walking on eggshells because you never knew what would happen. He could summon you and things would be great for you, or he could summon you and you're dead. You know, so it was pretty tricky working for the guy. So here he is. He's leading his people. But it says that at the beginning of this time when Esther shows up on the scene, the king is celebrating and he has this big banquet and he calls all his nobles and leaders and everything. They have this big bash in his man cave and he's having a great time and he decides to show off his queen to all his male friends. And so it says in verse 11, the king sent his servants telling them to bring before him Queen Vashti, wearing her royal crown in order to display her beauty to the people and nobles, for she was lovely to look at. Now, this is a pivotal moment for the queen. You see, Hebrew tradition tells us, doesn't come clearly in the English, but Hebrew tradition tells us that when he asked her to come and to wear her crown, that's all she wore. You get that? So this is why Vashti was not too thrilled about coming to see him, especially when all the king's friends and male friends were drunk and partying and everything. This was not a safe place for her to be. So she refused to come. Of course, this infuriated the king and would have embarrassed him in front of his friends that somebody would disobey his decree. And so he went to his advisors and said, you know, we got to do something about this. And so Queen Vashti was put out as queen. She was no longer the queen. And he goes to his advisor and says, so what do I do now? And they said, well, you got to get a new queen. And so they got all the pretty ladies from all over the kingdom to parade before the king. And this is what they proposed to him. Chapter 2, verse 2. Let a search be made for a beautiful young virgins for the king. And then let them be placed under the care of Haggai, the king's eunuch, who's in charge of the women. Let beauty treatments be given. And let the girl who pleases the king be queen instead of Vashti. And this appealed to him, and so they went ahead with it. Remember, he's got absolute power. So when the king says, I want your daughter to come to my palace, you send your daughter. And so all these people come to the palace to be chosen to see who's going to be his next queen. Now, into that backdrop, we're introduced to two Jews, Mordecai and Esther. And Esther, whose Jewish name is Hadassah, is her uncle. Her parents have passed away. She's an orphan. Chapter 2, verse 7. She was lovely. And Mordecai had raised her. And she is taken into the palace. So they all these women get this year-long spa treatment. Any ladies want that? Yeah. And at the end of that time, they're paraded before the king for him to choose. And you know the story. If you don't know the story, I encourage you to read Esther. It's a fascinating book. It's an easy story to read. But Esther is chosen. But unlike all the, you know, typical fairy tale stories where the king meets the princess and they live happily ever after, well, she becomes the queen. But things start to happen that are not so good. And we're introduced to this subplot in the story where there's a man named Haman who doesn't like the Jews. Seems to be a perpetual thing through history, doesn't it? Well, anyways, Mordecai is sitting near the city gates, and he is in the king's courts. And as an official in the king's, he would sit in the city gates, which is where a lot of important decisions are made. And he overhears two people plotting against the king. And so he sends word through Esther, and the plot is foiled. Chapter 2, verse 23. And when the report was investigated and found to be true, the two officials were hanged on the gallows. All this recorded in the book of the annals in the presence of the king. And so Mordecai becomes the hero. For that day, anyways. Chapter 3, verse 1 begins by saying, after these events, after this plot is foiled, says, King Xerxes honored Haman, son of Hammedatha, the Agagite. If anybody remember the Agagites, remember Saul refused to kill King Agag? Anyways, just a little thought to tie things in. And now all the royal officials of the king's gate knelt down and paid honor to Haman, for the king had commanded this concerning him, but Mordecai would not kneel down or pay honor to him. See, Mordecai was a strong, faithful believer in God. He knew that only God deserved that kind of honor, and so he refused to do this. Well, this made Haman's blood boil. And from that moment on, he was trying to find a plan to get rid of Mordecai. And not just Mordecai, but all of the Jews. And so he decided that they were going to have a plan to destroy the Jews. He set a date for it. Chapter 3, verses 8 to 9 of Esther. Then Haman said to King Xerxes, there's a certain people dispersed and scattered among the peoples in all the provinces of your kingdom, whose customs are different from those of all other peoples and do not obey the king's laws. It is not in the king's best interest to tolerate them. It, if it pleases the king, let a decree be issued to destroy them, and I will put 10,000 talents of silver into the royal treasury for the men who carry out this business. Now, 10,000 talents is a lot of money. In today's money, I don't know how they figure this out, but they figure it's something like $300 million. It's a lot of money. Now, and Haman, don't think that he was being ultra generous here. Just remember, he's going to kill off all the Jews. So where do you think he's going to get that money from? Robbing all those people that he, you know, it's kind of like the Holocaust and what happened in the Second World War. There was a lot of wealth garnished from all these people that were lost. Anyway, so Haman expected to have his wish granted. So the king hears Haman out and tells them in Esther chapter 3, verse 10. So the king took his signet ring from his finger and gave it to Haman, son of Hammedatha. Keep the money, the king said, and do with the people as you please. Now, when he gives the king's ring, that would seal letters that would go all over. When the king said it's to be done, it's law. He cannot go back on it. So on the 13th day of the first month, the royal secretaries were summoned. They wrote on the script of every province and in the language of each people all Haman's orders. And they dispatched that throughout the kingdom. Now, chapter 4, Mordecai, who's sitting at the king's gate, hears about what Haman has done. And he realizes the implications for himself, for Esther, for all the people. And he is overcome with grief and remorse. And he tears his clothes and he puts on sackcloth and ashes in mourning. And Esther hears that his uncle is in mourning. And he thinks, what's wrong with Uncle Mordecai? I don't get it. And so Mordecai sends word back to her and says, this is what's going on. You need to do something about this. And Esther responds. Now, this is where I want to focus in on this message. Esther chapter 4. And if you haven't already done so, please turn in your Bibles. Use the Bibles in the pew in front of you to turn to Esther. Esther is just after Nehemiah. Chapter 4. In chapter 4, listen to this. Beginning of verse 9. Hathach went back and reported to Esther what Mordecai had said. Then she instructed him to say to Mordecai, all the king's officials and all the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king has but one law, that he be put to death. The only exception to this is for the king to extend the gold scepter to him and spare his life. But 30 days have passed since I was called to go to the king. So Esther says, you know, we got a problem here, but I can't even get in to see him. What am I supposed to do? Listen to what Mordecai says, verse 12. Then Esther's words were reported to Mordecai. He sent back this answer. Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent, at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to royal position for such a time as this. Now, we could talk about those verses for a long time. See, here's the thing. God placed Esther in the royal courts for exactly this time. As we read through the whole story and we see how the Jews are eventually come out free, Mordecai gets honored and Haman is killed. That's the end of the story. But at this point is a very dangerous time. And see, one of the things when God places us in a position is that we often think that, what am I? Who am I? What am I supposed to do? I'm just me. I'm not important. And Esther says this to Mordecai. He says, look it, I'm just a young girl. The king hasn't called me in 30 days. I mean, think about that. 30 days. Your husband hadn't called you in to see him. And you know this is a guy who can do thumbs down and you're done, right? So she has to be very careful. And so her excuse is, what am I supposed to do? King hasn't called me, right? And see, often when God has placed you in an important place to do something for Him, our thought is, well, God hasn't hit me with a bolt of lightning. God hasn't done this for me. Nobody's come and told me what I need to do. So I'm just going to sit back. I'm safe here. But listen to what Mordecai says to her. He says, don't think, yeah, I know it's safe in the, you think it's safe in the king's courts. You know, sometimes we get lulled into thinking that we're safe just because we have all these comforts around us in North America. We got a roof over our head. Maybe you got a job. Maybe you're doing well. And we're thinking, I'm safe. I'm good. I've got my ticket to heaven. We're good. But what does he say here? He says, don't think that because you're in the king's house, in other words, in a good place, that you alone of all the Jews, of all the Christians, will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, and believe me, this is such a critical time in history, where God is opening doors all over this world, where people are coming to know Jesus every single day, where God is moving, His Spirit is moving, and God is doing things. If you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews, or we could say for the people of this world, will arise from another place. In other words, God's upper story carries on. God already has a story that He's moving towards. The question is, will we be a part of it? God has called you. Will you be faithful to what God has called you to do? He says, God, deliverance will come from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. In other words, don't think you can escape. Don't think because you feel like you're in a comfortable space that somehow that makes you exempt from what God sees. And who knows but that you have come to royal position for such a time of this as this. See, here's the thing. When we look at the book of Esther, we think, wow, that was so neat. I mean, look, this young girl, she saved the Jewish people. Good on her. That was wonderful. But I'm just going through life and I'm not royalty. I'm not into that. But God has placed every person in this room somewhere for a purpose. God has called each one of us to do what He has called us to do. God placed you in your family for a reason. God placed you in this church for a reason. God placed this church in this community for a reason. God placed you in your workplace for a reason. God brought you to this country for a reason. And don't think that if you just carry on doing your 9-to-5 routine every day, that somehow you will be spared. Because God says, if you love me, you will obey me. Here's the beautiful thing about it. God never expects us to do this alone. Even for Esther, she says, okay, whether I live or die, whatever. I'm going to go in and take my chances because we got something important to deal with here. But I want you to go. And behind her was all the Jews in a 3 days of fasting and prayer. And Esther knew that she had the backing of God and the backing of all the Jewish people praying for her. And you need to know that there are people in this church that are praying for you. You need to know that there are people outside this church that are praying for us. There are people praying for you that you will do what God has called you to do. And we need to be faithful. And so Esther takes her chances and goes. And you know the story of how King Xerxes found out about what Haman had planned. He could not take the law back. But he said, okay, here's another law I'm going to make, that all the Jews can arm themselves on that day that Haman said. And because of the favor that God gave the Jews, they were able to fight for themselves and were saved. And Haman was put to death. It's interesting that when we choose our own path, when we start focusing on what I want, things usually fall apart. Look at Haman. second in command in the country. He saw his life unfolding as he moved up in the hierarchy. He saw the king honor him. He saw Esther bring him into a meal. Think, man, I've got it pretty good. And then it all came crumbling down. You know, it may not fall apart tomorrow or the next day, but when we live only for ourselves, and don't think that just because you're retired that you're not. See, sometimes Satan deceives us into saying, you know what, I've given so much for God all my life, I'm done. And we start moving back into ourselves and looking after ourselves. And God says, as long as you are on this earth, I have a plan for you. Don't think that just because you're retired that I've got nothing for you to do. Or some of your young people are saying, well, I got to look after my family. And we get in this routine of trying to build our kingdoms, and we forget that God is the one who has called us, and he is the one we need to be faithful to. And so Esther comes into a place. Now, Esther would never have gotten into that place if there wasn't some prep time going on. See, often we think, well, who am I? I'm nobody. But if we're faithful, God is preparing you for something. For Esther, her uncle looked after her all her life and trained her to love God. And so that when she went into the king's court, she still had a heart for God. And she was ready for that moment to say, okay, Mordecai, here's what I need you to do. I need help. Let's do this. And she overcome with courage and she got back on track because she had been prepared. So it doesn't matter your background. Don't think that your background excuses you. There's a prep time. God prepares us in the good times for this special moment. We need the favor of God, just like Jesus had favor with God and man. Esther found favor with the king. But God works in his own time. It took a lifetime of growing up before God finally said, now's the time, Esther. Now you're ready. Now, don't think that just because you've lived a long time that it's still not coming. Maybe your best year, the best thing you ever do for God in his kingdom is coming up this year, next year, who knows? But if we are faithful to serve him in the little things, God will give us bigger things that he wants us to do. But your background does not hinder what God wants us to do. The interesting thing was all the way along in Israelite history, as that people were stuck in Babylon, people were praying for decades, for centuries, that God would redeem his people. And along comes Esther and stands in the gap to save the people of Israel. Does it sound like somebody else who came just at the right time? Remember Jesus? History is flowing for thousands of years, and all of a sudden, just at the right time, it says in Galatians, but when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, but that we might receive adoption to sonship. Aren't you glad that Jesus, a carpenter born in a stable, didn't say, I'm just a carpenter's kid. I know I belong to God, but I'm good. I'm going to go back to heaven anyways. But he said, no, God has given me a purpose, and I will follow that purpose right to the cross. Amen. And because Jesus died for us, he saved us all. And we are so thankful that there is a Redeemer who comes to us, who can save us if we will let him. And as I mentioned at the beginning, Jesus said to his apostles in the book of John chapter 15, you didn't choose me. I chose you. What for? To go and bear fruit. Jesus never said, I chose you because I need more people to fill up heaven. He says, I chose you to go and bear fruit. If somebody was to look at your life, would they see fruit? Would they see a life that is full of the Spirit? If we're not there yet, I mean, many of us mess up. We can keep coming to him, and God will continue to prepare you for that one day where he has something amazing for you to do. Now, the amazing thing for you to do might be nothing compared to somebody else like Billy Graham. But that amazing thing might just be being faithful for Jesus in your family. Being faithful for Jesus in the home where you live. Being faithful to Jesus in sharing the word with that one neighbor who has never heard about Jesus or doesn't know him yet. It says also in the New Testament, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing in his kingdom, in view of perspective of this upper story, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. And people, that's not just for preachers. Preaching the word is for all of us. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instructions. God loves us, and he longs to pour out his Spirit among us to do incredible things. For such a time as this, God has called us. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, I just thank you so much that you are here this morning and you're speaking to us. Lord, you have given us the blessing of not having to work into our old age in this country often. God, I just pray that we would use that time wisely for such a time as this, where there are people flooding into our country who desperately need to know you. God, I pray that you would speak into our lives and show us the one thing that you have called us to do today, even if it's a little thing. Help us not to get distracted by overwhelming things, but do the one thing your Spirit is telling us. In Jesus' name, amen. Yesterday, I was at a seminar downtown in the library downtown. It was a seminar to help people that want to sponsor refugees. You know who was in that room? There's about 10 of us, my daughter and I. There's a couple guys from Eritrea, a couple guys from Sudan, another guy from Afghanistan who had come through Tajikistan, and another one from the Middle East. There are people all over who are new to this country who are sponsoring their friends and neighbors, family to come over here because they love this country. Did you know that every year between 250 and 300,000 people are coming here from all over the world? And guess what they need? They need what we've got. They need Jesus. Amen? And God has brought the world to us. You don't even have to be a missionary to remote areas anymore. They're coming right here. For such a time as this, what has God called you to? In closing, let's just stand together and let's sing number 718.
Day by day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond all measure gives unto each day when he deems best. Lovingly, it's part of pain and pleasure. Mingled with content rest. Every day the Lord himself is near me with a special mercy for each hour. All my cares he fain would bear and cheer me. He whose name is Counselor and Power. Of his guardian treasure is a charm set on himself he laid. As your days, your strength shall be in measure. This the pledge to
to me he has made. Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust thy promises, O Lord, that I lose not face sweet consolation offered me within your holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble me take, e'er to take as from a father's hand. One by one, the days, the moments fleeting, till I reach the promised land.
Every day the moments are fleeting, going by, aren't they? We can't recover that time, but we can use today and tomorrow and the next day, whatever God gives us, for his glory and his honor. I want to encourage you to go and make a commitment to really serve God with all your heart. Some of you have never been baptized. It's time for you to commit yourself to serving Jesus. Some of you have never become members of this church, and you need to commit yourself to serving the body of Christ, just as we serve the head. Let's go in his grace and capture the moment that God has given you and the place that God has put you for his glory. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.